Hello, this is Paul Connett, Director of the Fluoride Action Network. I have the pleasure of introducing Dr. Ghali, an unexpected hero. In this topsy-turvy world of fluoridation, to be a hero today, you only have to be professional. You have to say the truth, speak the truth, and you become a hero. It's so rare with in the policy in which the professional bodies and health agencies in the fluoridated world, which is the small part of the planet, but the fluoridated world, are so locked into fluoridation. We've just come expecting just to get the mantra of fluoridation is safe and effective, safe and effective. Dr. Ghali broke away from that mantra in the hearing in Calgary on October the 29th. Dr. Ghali is the director of the O'Brien Institute, which was expected to give a ringing endorsement of fluoridation in Calgary. Instead, the O'Brien Institute neither endorsed nor opposed fluoridation. They said neither yes or no. And the reason that they couldn't give an endorsement is because of the concerns about neurotoxicity. And you're going to hear those concerns about neurotoxicity in the presentation he gave on October the 29th. There are two or three high points to this. He mentions the Bashash study from 2017. This is the first study which showed a relationship between exposure to the pregnant woman and lowered IQ in children. He mentions the Green study. This came out in 2019, which essentially replicated the Bashash study. And then he mentions the National Toxicology Program review, a draft review of the whole issue of fluoride's neurotoxicity, which came out about a week before he spoke in October the 29th. So here is Dr. Ghali then, an unexpected hero in this battle for the truth on fluoride's neurotoxicity.
But the research that's actively ongoing, and it's not just the August 19th Canadian study published by a group at York, it's also recent research published in from Mexico and some prior research before that. And it's very controversial. Anti-fluoride groups are saying, see, this is a poison that is affecting brains. This is the biggest shameful moment in the history of public health. So that's the narrative you have. Pro-fluoride advocacy perspectives are attacking the research and saying it's discredited, it's terrible research. So that's what's being said, and you're gonna. I mean, again, I say this respectfully. I think we're gonna hear that in this chamber today. In between those two viewpoints, I'm going to say there are credible peer-reviewed journals that are publishing this work. The most recent Canadian study was published in JAMA Pediatrics. Anyone knows that publishing in the JAMA Network journals, Journal of the American Medical Association, incredibly difficult. Work is scrutinized. And this particular work was actually double reviewed, and there was a supplementary statistical review for the August 19th Canadian study. There are accompanying editorials that have far from discredited the work, that have said that this requires attention and needs to be considered in context of other evidence that's emerging. The studies can't be undone, and they can't be unpublished. Huge amount of public resources, both of the big cognition studies were funded by the NIH, National Institutes of Health, which is incredibly competitive funding, tremendous amount of rigor in the review of the proposals to do the work, and then many years to do the work. And if there's one thing that I get angry about as a person who supports research is the notion that you can just talk away the 10 years of work by committed investigators. That's the only thing I get angry about, because I respect the doers of the research and the deliverers of the evidence, and I don't think they should be shot for tough messages. There was a Cadeth rapid review. So Cadeth did the big review, and at Dr. Figueredo's request, a Cadeth rapid review was done of recent cognition studies related to fluoridated water supplies. Cadeth reviewed the literature and through that process identified one notable new study, and that is the York University study of several Canadian cities that found an association between high intake of fluoride or higher intake of fluoride in pregnancy and lower cognition in children some years later. A finding that for the best measure of fluoride intake, which is urinary fluoride, was only seen in boys, not girls. Other measures of fluoride intake were seen in both boys and girls in terms of cognitive effects. The Cadeth review did the process of reviewing the study design, were confounders attended to, was the analysis correct, number of things. Were there selection biases? Was the sample size sufficient? And they identify a number of limitations that, again, I think you're going to hear about. And then they make a bottom line conclusion. The evidence, this is verbatim, the evidence is weak due to multiple limitations. But then they also say this cannot be ignored, and further well-conducted research is now needed to address uncertainty. So that's the Cadeth comment on the cognition study from August 19th. On Tuesday last week, a U.S. report in draft form was released by the National Toxicology Program. And this is a formal systematic review, very extensive, and it is informing a November 6th public hearing in Washington, D.C. So if any of you want to go on a trip and visit the Lincoln Memorial, November 6th. And this review looked at a far broader sweep, 149 human studies and 339 animal studies on fluoride intake and cognition. And the review, this is verbatim, concludes, there is a consistent pattern of findings that high fluoride exposure is associated with decreased intelligence, IQ, in children. And then they go on to say, NTP, so the National Toxicology Program, concludes that fluoride is presumed to be a cognitive neurodevelopmental hazard to humans. And the presumed category is a formal designation where potential toxins are alleged, possible, potential, and then it goes to presumed and definite. To be a definite neurotoxin, there would have to be a clinical trial demonstrating the neurotoxicity, and there can never be a clinical trial of this. So observational research like that conducted is what, that's the highest level that it will have given the evidence. And then they conclude, these are verbatim, this conclusion is based on a consistent pattern of findings in human studies. So for the suggestion that there's only one study, there's one study in a community water fluoridation context, there's many studies, and notably there's a Mexico City study where the levels of fluoride are similar to the Canadian fluoridated cities. They say, and this is important, when focusing on findings from studies with exposures in ranges typically found in the U.S. relating to fluoridation, effects on cognitive neurodevelopment are inconsistent and therefore unclear. So I want to say that because we have to hear that, inconsistent and unclear. So an editorial comment from the Institute team, no one knows for sure, and no one should act sure, because if they act sure, they can't be sure. We're trying to be really objective and balanced, and we're just giving you verbatim statements. There have been calls very recently for access to the data from the recent York University study, and in a letter that was sent to the NIH last week, 20 or so North American academics wrote to the NIH denouncing the recent Canadian cognition study, critiquing it on many levels, making assertions that the team at York University has refused giving access to their data. and they're refusing to permit reanalysis, and they are not being transparent. These allegations are false. The authors, in fact, are in an active process of discussing with Health Canada a Teflon bias-free process of making the data available for a secondary analysis. And again, I said there's one thing that really gets under my skin, and that's an assertion, like attacking messengers.
Nice to meet you. My name is Dr. Aravind Ganesh. I'm a resident physician. I'm a researcher with the Department of Clinical Neurosciences at the University of Calgary, and I was one of the contributors of the information to the O'Brien Institute's fluoridation report. I'd like to speak a little bit more just about one of the principles that guided our work in preparing this report for the city, because I think that's important to emphasize when dealing with an issue that tends to generate strong opinions, and that's basically what I want to talk about with you today. Indeed, even before today's public discussion, the O'Brien Institute's report had already generated plenty of strong opinions from various groups and individuals, as you've already heard. And I think a big reason for that is because the report did include some unexpected and uncomfortable findings on certain topics, as Dr. Ghali and others have already discussed. Now, if we as medical and public health researchers are to be considered scientists, then we must be scientific in our approach. And that means we must be guided by the evidence, not by ideology, but by evidence. And the most rigorous test of a scientist, in my opinion, is this. What do we do when we are confronted by unexpected data or by unexpected results? Particularly when those results go against what we have been taught or against traditions that we hold dear. And this is precisely what happened, Council, with our report on the fluoridation issue. As a physician and as a public health researcher, I've always been taught that fluoridation is one of the most important public health achievements of the 20th century. This, after all, is something that you can see right on the website of the Centers for Disease Control in the United States. So I went into writing this report fully expecting to say that fluoride is beneficial and probably not harmful. This was my hypothesis, if you will. And doing that doesn't make me right or wrong. That's just how science works. You go in with a hypothesis and then we see whether it holds up in the face of evidence. And our work as a team included not only reviewing the relevant literature, but as mentioned previously, also reaching out to important stakeholders and to the scientists who conducted this research, really so that we could better understand their approach and their rationale. For example, I met in person with Dr. Philippe Grandjean, who is a leading toxicology researcher at Harvard University, and who authored an important review paper on potential developmental toxicity of fluoride. So over the course of this process, my colleagues and I came across new evidence in the last few months to the last year that raised some important uncertainties about fluoride. As discussed already, it's by no means conclusive evidence, but it raises questions about things like developmental toxicity that merit further exploration. So this brings me back to that question, Council, that I asked earlier, which is what do we as scientists do when we're confronted by unexpected data? And if we simply sweep it aside and seek to discredit it without proper consideration, just because we don't agree with it or it doesn't agree with our prior hypothesis, then we can't call ourselves scientists. We're just ideologues. And at the same time, we can't just discount everything else we know just because this is the new hot trend or hot topic. So if we are to call ourselves true scientists, I believe that we must acknowledge this evidence, and I think that's exactly what we did in this report. We put that all into the report. And whether the recent evidence that's been presented today is ultimately held up as the truth and taught to the next generation of physicians, only time will tell. And that's uncomfortable. But that's the nature of truth in medicine, and that's what I've come to understand, is that we must acknowledge that there is uncertainty in this moment in time. But what I hope is that 20 years on, when all of us as researchers and contributors look back to how each of us acted in this moment in time, we'll hopefully be able to say that we were true to our scientific principles. Thank you for your time.